This is a wake-up call that Ebola can come here at any time if nothing's done to eradicate it in the West African region.
Welcome back to Byline. I'm Faith Goldie in for Brian Lilly, the widow of an Ebola victim speaking earlier today in Minneapolis. The deadly virus has landed in the United States and there are huge concerns it will spread. Earlier this week, a Liberian man in Texas became the first confirmed case to hit the U.S. Now there are more suspected cases. An American journalist with a confirmed case is on his way to the United States. Straight Talk contributor Kevin Gaudette joins us now. Kevin, right before I get to you, I got to play this latest clip coming out of the CDC on their efforts to contain the virus. Take a look.
Every place where Ebola is spreading, our number one recommendation is to establish what we call an incident management system, where one person is in charge and you break down the tasks into smaller tasks to make sure that everything gets done and followed up. And that's been done in Texas. They've done exactly what we've recommended. They have an incident manager in place. We're supporting that person. The state of Texas is supporting that person. And I'm confident we'll break the chain of transmission there.
Kevin, I hear the words incident management team and systems, and it sounds like they're doing a lot. Have they done enough to actually contain this virus?
I think they've done what they need to do. They're acting with an abundance of caution is the language they use. They're now monitoring up to 80 people in Dallas. Chances are that nobody has escaped their dragnet. Now, it's not clear how many of those 80 could actually have Ebola and then subsequently die from it, but chances are there'll be nobody they've missed.
Is there a chance that this thing could mutate, especially if the incidence of cases rises?
Well, there is a chance. Diseases don't generally mutate quickly. So this is the 19th or 20th outbreak of Ebola since 1976. They've all been fairly small. So the disease hasn't had a great chance to get out widely and have a chance to replicate itself and change itself much. So the more it gets a chance to get out and replicate, the more it could mutate. But these things don't generally happen overnight or weeks or months. So it's the type of thing they will keep an eye on.
Now, I want to pivot to Canada. Is this thing a threat to us here? I mean, disease knows no geographical boundaries.
Well, the fact of the matter is we've got some 7,000 plus people that they're aware of, at least in Africa, that have been diagnosed with Ebola so far. And given world transportation networks being what they are, it's going to come here. We've already got a patient in Toronto who's suspected or being monitored for Ebola. Turns out he may be from Nigeria, which hasn't had a positive case for over 3 weeks. So there's a very, very low likelihood that he has Ebola. But chances are it's going to get here. It'll probably get to the United States again. It'll probably get to the UK. We can stamp these things out quickly. They're going to spread when they get here briefly in small amounts, like in Dallas we see. But we'll be able to stamp them out. They don't spread like in Africa. But until we stamp out the problem in Africa, it'll keep leaking into other countries.
So that leads me to really two other questions. The first one being, well, shouldn't we just quarantine West Africa then, stop the flights, stop the disease from coming to our borders?
Well, there's a lot of talk about the possibility of that. Again, transportation networks being what they are, it's difficult to do that because there's not just direct, you can go overland or over water to other countries and then get to Canada or any other country through secondary routes. Some people would like to close the borders to primary flights. I think that there might be some arguments for isolation approaches instead, perhaps. But to be fair, there's been a bunch of people come, and we still have only had one case so far.
Now, the second question is the difference. I mean, you say that, okay, in Western countries here, in Western cities, we have a better ability to contain the virus, certainly. Questions emerging whether or not that Dallas guy basically came here for our better abilities to contain and treat it. But the other side of that coin is, isn't there a higher chance of contagions? Here, I'm thinking about the transit system. I'm thinking about our big malls. We hang out in big crowds in Western cities, do we not?
Well, Monrovia's got, in like capital of Liberia, has got 1.5 million people.
And it's the worst hit, isn't it?
It is, but it's a meaningful size. And the difference there is they don't have communication systems. A lot of people are afraid of the disease. They're afraid to report it. They're afraid to go to hospitals. The hospitals are too full. They don't have treatment protocols. They don't have medical personnel. I mean, this is a country that's gone through years and years of civil war. It's got little infrastructure, little health care. We have infrastructure. We have health care. We have protocols. We've learned from the SARS experience. So when it arrives, you see what happens in Dallas. They nail the individual quickly. They contact all the individuals he or she has contacted, and they monitor those people. And that contact tracing will shut down the spread of it relatively quickly.
Well, Kevin, you're more optimistic than me. We'll have to see where this thing goes. All right.